Welcome to Inside the Taubman Approach. I'm Benjamin Harding. Today's episode is an interview with Elizabeth Grace. Hers is a story of incredible strength and resolve in discovering how to play the piano with ease and without pain through the Taubman Approach. Her harrowing journey in the Taubman work through the support and encouragement from her family and husband was accompanied with superior focus and determination to learn all that she could. The end result is stunning. She is a master teacher and is performing at the highest level. Don't miss a second of this interview. Go to the show notes to find out everything about Elizabeth Grace at her website. And let's get you connected with a certified Taubman teacher at GolandskyInstitute.org. Elizabeth is a master teacher at the Golandsky Institute. Let's get you connected to her. Let's jump into today's episode. Can you tell? I'm really excited. Let's get into it. Elizabeth Grace, welcome to Inside the Taubman Approach.
It is my distinct honor and pleasure.
How did you come across the Taubman work?
Well, I stumbled upon it very much by accident. This was very long ago. I got injured, I hate to say it, but about 40 years ago this summer, and I went to the hand specialists in Omaha where I lived, and I did, over the course of a year and a half to 2 years, 16 medical tests and treatments. And the last visit to the doctor, he said, well, we can be really happy that you don't have cancer or a brain tumor. And I said, well, my hands still hurt. And he walked to the door and he said, be sure to come back and see me if you have any further problems. And he walked out. And so I went to another hand specialist who said, I had some tendonitis, frozen shoulder, thoracic outlet syndrome, you know, a number of things they said I had, whether I really had them, I don't know, it doesn't matter. But the new guy said I wouldn't play again. And so I thanked him for his honesty. And I left, and I was talking to a friend of mine who in a very brusque way, said I needed to really get to the bottom of why I couldn't play, because I told her I was probably going to have to stop and become an interior designer or a real estate agent. Those were the things that appealed to me. So she said, you've got to make it your life's work to figure this out. And, oh, I was so broken by that time. I'd had so much, and this was not a popular topic. I was playing professionally in the Omaha Symphony and teaching at a university there. And, oh, it was an awful time. And so I took my friend's advice to heart, and I realized that it was probably my playing that was causing the problem, because I wasn't doing anything else. I mean, it was a nice vacation from cleaning the house and, you know, doing a lot of other things. So I didn't use my hands very much. So that was joyful. But I figured out it must be something in my playing, even though the doctor told me the whole time to keep playing, that was fine. So I recall one day that a good friend of mine had come through town. Her name is Kendall Feeney. And she was a friend of mine from Aspen and a music festival in Florida. And she had come through Omaha a couple years prior, and she said she had gotten injured and she was studying with somebody in New York, and I just thought, this is the kookiest thing I've ever heard, but okay. I hate to admit it, but I just thought, how could that be? Nobody ever talked about this. But I decided that I would do anything to fix myself that was non-invasive. So she told me about the Taubman Institute that was at that time in Amherst, Massachusetts. And so I signed up. And I remember I received this pamphlet in the mail, and I liked the questions that were answered, like the myth of the weak fourth finger, and is there a doctor in the house? And some of the other questions really piqued my interest. And so I flew out there and I thought, well, it's only money, which right. I had spent a lot of money. It's not like I had a lot of money, but I thought it's non-invasive, it's educational, and I'm going to give it a shot. So I went there and I listened to the lectures that Edna gave, mm-hmm. and they made so much sense to me. And I generally have been and still am a person who doesn't jump on the latest bandwagon of the newest fad or trend. And I sat in those lectures and she gave the demonstrations of how to move your fingers and, you know, and the twists, everything. And I thought, why haven't I heard about this? This is, of course, it should be like this. So I filed that away. I happened to run into Mrs. Taubman in the restroom. And she asked me she said, how's it going, dear? And I said, well, not very well. I don't have a teacher yet here. And I'm hurt and it's getting close to the end of the summer. She said, see me after the class. And so I did. I played for her and she said, well, I can fix you if you move to Brooklyn. Well, my husband had just gotten transferred to Houston, Texas, so we were moving. So I said, well, I can't move to Brooklyn. But hearing the words, I can fix you, I mean, I get emotional right now just thinking mm-hmm. about yeah. that, mostly because of what I'd been through, you know, all of these things prior. But I am a fighter and a survivor, and it made so much sense to me. So Mrs. Taubman then said, well, maybe Eleanor Hancock would take you as a commuting student. And she lived in Manhattan. Well, this is a girl from the Midwest who's never been to Manhattan. And anyway, I called my dear husband from the street of Amherst, Massachusetts, and I was sobbing. And I said, she says I have to move or come to meet you. And he said, we'll just find a way to make it work. And wow. for that, I've always been and still am to this day so grateful. So I wrote to Eleanor, and she agreed to take me as a student. And I had met a woman, Elaine Strauss, at Amherst that summer who said, well, if you decide to come study in New York, you have a place to stay. She lived in New Jersey. And so I did. She taught me so much. And she was in my life for the past 38 years, and she just passed away in April, and I'm going out in November to California to play at her memorial service. But she made it possible for me to study with Eleanor, and I went to Princeton, and, you know, and so I studied with Eleanor for like 20 years, then she passed away, and she told me that I was afraid when she was going to be gone that I wouldn't know how to. She said, oh, dear, you have everything you need. And so I was on my own with all of it, and I did not feel a particular gap. But my friend Elaine knew all about the Golandsky Institute, and so she introduced me to Edna. And I believe Bob was in New York, and I met him. And then I signed up to go to the Princeton Institute, and I really liked that. Because I liked the fact that, and I still do, that the information is so unified and so streamlined. And there's, of course, everyone says things in their own way, but all of the material is coming from the same source.
Yes.
And that's been very comforting over the years. But also, I really believe in it, because if I have any problem with a student, I have, you know, mentors, Edna mm-hmm. and John are my mentors, and I just feel very supported in that way. So that's a long answer to a short question, but it has been a long and winding road through 5 moves in different cities and having a couple of children along the way, and it hasn't been easy, but the best things in life aren't easy. You have to work to get the reward of it. And so
Kind of immediate relief after studying the work initially at Amherst and then going to New York, or was that a process?
Absolutely did not get immediate relief.
Yeah.
And in fact, I started with Eleanor in September. And on November the 9th, I ended up commuting to New York City every other week. And wow. I took maybe 5 hours of lessons. Eleanor was incredibly generous with her time, and I got lucky in the airline fee department. And so I really feel so blessed it worked out. But Eleanor took me to Mrs. Taubman in Brooklyn because I was still having trouble. And Mrs. Taubman kept saying, "How does that feel, dear? How does that feel, dear?" And I said, "I feel so frustrated."
Yeah.
And so I did not get immediate relief, but I had no options. You know, I don't want to sugarcoat it. It was either this or nothing. And so I was not a person who had listened to a lot of YouTube videos and podcasts and the streaming service and all of that. And I only knew one person who lived in New York at the time, and he was going to Juilliard. He was a good friend. And I said, "What do you know about this?" He said, "Oh, I think it's just a cult." He said, I would stay away from it. Well, that was really discouraging, but I thought, well, that's his opinion about this. And I'm going to see this through for a while because it's non-invasive. You know, I mean, when people say, "Oh, I'm going to do carpal tunnel surgery" or some of these things, this is much more serious than filling your brain with knowledge in the hopes that something takes. So it was a long journey, but I will say that I commuted to New York and studied there. And after about 2 years, I played a Beethoven sonata on a concert at my previous college. They had bought a new Burzendorfer, and I got to be part of the concert to inaugurate it. And I think I had had a baby in the middle of that 2 years.
Wow.
So, you know, the combo, and I moved to Texas. So there's a lot going on. But I was able to play after 2 years. It didn't take 2 years, but I performed after 2 years and had a lot of other things going on in my life. So I wasn't just studying and doing nothing else. So,
Right. That's incredible. That's incredible. And so you were exposed to this amazing work serendipitously through a friend in Omaha, and then were able to kind of just, wow, what a journey. And then life, of course, happens, and you're pursuing this, because this was the final option. I mean, to your point, and you had already gone through graduate school at this point. I mean, music is such a big part of your life. I can imagine how devastating that must have been to experience this kind of pain. What kind of pain were you experiencing?
I had the pain. I got it in my hand, right around my thumb area.
Okay.
And I had decided I was going to be a pianist when I went to college. And so I approached it with vigor. I could always play the piano and I liked it. But when I decided I was going to be a pianist and I was going to win competitions,
right,
my practicing took on a different level. I believe because I kept playing and I favored my hand, I tightened my shoulder and I eventually got frozen shoulder. So I couldn't raise my arms above my head. And this thoracic outlet syndrome, you know, I'm not 100% sure. It doesn't really matter. But the pain was largely in my hands. And now that I'm on the other side of it, I think back to this doctor telling me to go ahead and play. So I'd ice my hands, after I played, and I'd use heat before I played. And when I went jogging, I would do some ice or heat and this and that. And I just thought that maybe it would get better with all of that, but it didn't change. It got worse, actually. So it lasted. I think if I would have known what I know now, of course, hindsight's 20/20. Of course, if anybody has injury problems now, there's a much better network. And at the time I got injured, I had remembered when I was at Aspen, there was a doctor at Aspen who I believe was at the Cleveland Clinic. And I contacted her during the doctor years. And I also went to the Houston Clinic for Performing Arts once I moved there and talked to that doctor there. And
sure.
Did some physical therapy and things. But really, ultimately, I knew that it must be my playing. And so, and I know now, I've gone back to old scores and I see the fingering I had put in there and, you know, pull my hands, stretch it, grip the finger. You know, I wrote these things like grip or really dig in. You know, I wrote these things in my score and I've saved them because it's just a great reminder of where I was then and where I am now.
And yeah, and fast forward, I mean, 40 years or so in the work, teaching at a master level, you've pursued certification through the Golandsky Institute. What kinds of problems and issues do you solve on a day-to-day basis with your students? I mean, what's that like? And that's got to be so fulfilling for you.
We'll be back after a quick break.
This summer, Edna Golandsky, renowned pedagogue and leading expert on the Taubman approach, will release her first book with Amplify Publishing Group, entitled The Taubman Approach to Piano Technique, a comprehensive guide to overcome physical limitations and unlock your full pianistic potential. The book will be available for an early purchase in June exclusively on Edna's website and at online retailers such as Amazon and Barnes & Noble this August. Visit EdnaGolandsky.com to learn more.
Well, it's been, it is and has been a fantastic journey because when I had to move all of these times, I had to start a new studio. But when you move to a new community, you get a lot of transfer students. And so I was able to see firsthand what people were doing that may not cause them injury. I always laughed and said, and I do say, well, my students at that time, particularly, they would never practice enough to get injured. But the truth is you can get injured with any amount of practicing. But, you know, but bringing them in fresh kids, you know, you get the opportunity to work with them from the ground up, which is rewarding because you can put in the right things from the start. And that doesn't mean they're going to do the right things from the start. But it's the teacher's job to know where you have to take the student and to keep saying the right message and work toward the right goal. So if there's collapse, you just keep working toward it. The transfer students, you know, I took a different approach, always knowing in the back of my mind what I needed to fix. But, you know, you have to, shall we say, win them over. You can't just totally tear down their technique. So you have to approach it a little bit differently. And I've had a lot of adult students. And I have had a lot of elderly adult students over the course of my journey. So I feel like I've taught the gamut from, you know, age 4 to 94. But what I see now more than anything are injured people or those who want to take their technique to a different level because they have limitations, or adults who realize, because I have worked with them now for several years or more, the value and the importance and the success rate of doing what the Taubman approach provides. So lots of time, I spend a lot of time with people coming into my studio who are college students or who have a career and they can't play. And I have to say, you know, I used to feel stressed about, can't teach them everything. I can't teach everybody everything. And, you know, there's all this bad technique going on and I didn't want to be negative. And all of that, but I could see that there were these problems. But I finally decided, you know, to just affect one life at a time. And whoever I affect change with will affect change, and they know the difference, and they will take it to their community, whether they're a teacher or a grandfather or a young kid or a prodigy, you know, wherever people are. And so now I feel really happy that whoever I work with, I get to affect their life in a way that I hope they'll take it to their community, as I said, and work with them. On my website, I have a quote by Krista McAuliffe, the astronaut that was killed in an accident. And it says, I touch the future, .. I teach. It could be backwards. I'd have to check it on my website. But it might be, I teach, but I think it's, I can look it up. But, you know, that is my mission statement of as a pianist. And anybody that I get to work with and share this knowledge with, and anyone I can keep from having to go through what I went through, I feel like it's a win. And actually, as a side note, in 2014, I was named the Kansas Outstanding Teacher of the Year.
Right.
And, of course, it was an honor, and I am still filled with gratitude for that award. But what I was awarded the honor for, in part, was my work with injured people. And in my acceptance speech, I said, you know, sometimes your greatest work is not done with your greatest student that wins a competition. But anybody that you can keep out of trouble is, or get out of trouble, is extremely rewarding.
Yeah.
There's nothing like it, you know? There's nothing like it. And I really feel so grateful that I have this knowledge, because there aren't very many people in the Midwest that have had this training.
Right.
And so I feel like if somebody has trouble, they can come to me. And I feel grateful for the teacher certification program and then the teacher referral program through the Institute. That is a real gift to the world.
It really is. And dear listener, as you're listening to this podcast, we're going to be including in our show notes all the links that you can get in touch with Elizabeth and the Golandsky Institute, of course. Wherever you're at in the world, we can help to link you up with a certified teacher. Elizabeth, you've taken education very, very seriously throughout your career, and that's demonstrated in so many different ways. Masters from Eastman, and as you just mentioned, Teacher of the Year in Kansas in 2014. How would you encourage somebody like me who has just started in the Taubman work? Would you encourage somebody like me to pursue certification? What would you say to somebody like me that's interested, that's not sure, that might be listening to this episode and saying, hey, I'd like to see what it entails. What was the certification process like for you, and how did that go?
Well, the certification process was not in existence when I started the Taubman work with Eleanor Hancock. And so once I got into working with the Golandsky Institute, I decided that I had had a lot of background. And when I was going to Edna and she was looking at my technique we were working on whatever gaps she thought I had and everything. And so I was involved in the Taubman approach a very long time before I even applied for the certification program. And it's an extensive program with extensive requirements. And I think that's fantastic, because this is very detailed, because micro work in minute detail. And so my advice to someone considering the certification program is to take as many lessons as is humanly possible that you can afford and that work out and you know, depending on where you live. But in my, when I first began, of course, there was no Skype, no online, nothing. It was fly to New York City or California or forget it. Now you can have a lesson every week, twice, whatever you and your teacher say. So I would keep your eye on the journey and the working out of the technique so that your hands can do it. And so that you feel confident, because, you know, it's often said you can't teach what you can't do. And you want to be able, in this work particularly, now maybe I could teach somebody how to, you know, have better form riding their bike when I'm not doing that. I don't know. But I know in this work that you don't want to be unsure yourself and misguiding somebody. So I think the journey is to have lessons and go to the seminars and the workshops and ask questions and more questions and more questions about anything that doesn't seem 100% clear in your brain. Because one of the things that I found so joyful when I went to Eleanor is that she was interested in knowing what I couldn't do, instead of me performing for her as I had done when I was at Eastman. You know, you go in and you show that you've memorized the Tchaikovsky piano concerto in 1 week, and you're ready to play with the orchestra. You know, it was this proving kind of a situation, and that's just the way it was set up. Not really. That's a very big exaggeration. But when I would go to the lessons, it was, you know, show how much I had learned, and we would work musically on it. I found it challenging when I started the Taubman approach, because no one had ever in all my years of study asked me how anything felt. This was not a part of anything I had ever thought about or considered. So when Mrs. Taubman said, "How does that feel?" I said, "I feel frustrated, but I know that's not the answer to the question, but I don't know how it felt. I just followed it blindly. And so, of course, as a commuter, I taped every lesson on a cassette tape recorder. And I listened to the recordings when I flew home and then when I got home. And I wrote down every word on the recording. And then I studied the words as I tried to put it into my hands until I went back the next time. And I remember worrying that I wasn't doing it enough right, better. You know, I'm a classic perfectionist of the highest order, which has its pros and cons.
Yes.
But she said, "Just try to do what you did in the lesson, dear, and I'll fix the rest." And that was very helpful to calm my nerves, because I was pretty uptight about the amount of money I spent every trip. I mean, it was at least $1,000, and this was 40 years ago, 38 years ago to be exact, you know, so. And I didn't have that kind of money, so I was pretty uptight about that. And so that's how I did it. So I would tell anyone who'd like to be certified to immerse yourself in every piece of it that you can.
Yeah.
And when you listen to a video or watch a demonstration, if something isn't clear, take it to the lesson.
Yeah.
Because we can't really learn piano technique only by watching somebody else do it on a video. We can stimulate the mind and get the concepts in our brain. But when it comes to the doing, you need the supervision of somebody who knows this work well.
Yeah. What kinds of things are exciting you currently in your studio, in your work, in your own playing, perhaps? What kinds of things are sort of exciting you right now in your studio work?
Well, it sounds very silly, but everything excites me, except paperwork and emails about scheduling.
Yeah, there's no Taubman approach for email scheduling.
No. Right. I have to say that the more you study it, the better it gets. things become clearer, your hands can do more, you find an answer to something that you thought you just couldn't do it because you weren't talented enough. Yeah. You know, I just finished listening to all of the lectures at the Golandsky Institute seminar and in the symposium. And, you know, the fascinating answers to questions that people are struggling with. And a lot of times it's a small little in or a small little out, or, and that might be overwhelming to people thinking, well, how am I supposed to know? You know, again, it takes a lot of experience and a lot of time and energy and knowledge and dedication. But I remember when my kids were doing sports, they were, one of them was going to be entering the state finals for soccer. And the coach got him in the huddle and said, you'll win or lose this game by the little things. It's all in the details, and you will either win or lose by little mistakes you make or the other team makes. And the team took it to heart. My son's team won. But I remember hearing that thinking, that's how it is.
That's beautiful.
And yeah. That's how we must think. That. So what excites me is growing in my knowledge of all the details and studying all the repertoire possible to learn what makes that composer tick. Where are the problem spots? How do you solve them? And sometimes the way I solve it is nothing I could have had in mind 10 years ago. I mean, and now my, and the growth in my hands excites me. That my hands
do. Your own playing.
Yeah. And one of the most exciting things happened to me some years ago. I got injured playing the Brahms F minor quintet after I played that in a carpeted room on a Baldwin piano at a music festival. I'm sure that the injury was coming, you know, but that was when I felt pain. And so I didn't ever look at it for 30 years, but when I got injured and I was rehabilitating, I said, if I could just play the Brahms chamber music, that's all. Just if I could just have one gift, it would be the Brahms chamber music. So a few years ago, I was teaching at the University of Denver at a summer camp, Lamont School of Music summer program, and I was asked to play the Brahms quintet again. And so I took it to Edna, and I took it, I think, to John, but I took it to Edna, and I said, what do you think? And she said, I think you can do it. And I think, and I took it to John and said, he said, I think you can do this. And I did it. And it was so much better than it ever would have been before. And while it's a very difficult piece, I've worked out all of the thorny passages. And I remember I played it like I had written it myself. It was so rewarding. And I felt like, okay, I've come full circle.
That is such a beautiful story. And wow, your story is so inspiring. And I know it's going to be so inspiring to the listener. And what a story of perseverance in music, and something that you loved.
Yeah.
All the moves that you've gone through, all the family dynamic things, life happens, right? Life happens.
Yeah.
But it is possible for people to your point, not only experience healing if they're injured, but also to excel in piano playing through this approach to heights unknown. And so this is so exciting. Is there a way that people can get in touch with you if they want to study with you in Kansas?
Yes, they can go to BethGrace.com. Pretty simple.
Yeah. Absolutely. And of course.
Or of course, through the Golandsky Institute, you know, through the teacher referral program as well. You know, but I'm here and
absolutely.
Doing, you know, I really do want to help people get out of a mess, or if they're not in a mess, get to the other side of it, which the other side is infinite. But it makes you feel so empowered because you learn tools, you learn skills, you develop a skill set on your own. So unlike some types of training where it get a little softer here and you get a little louder there, I mean, that's part of it. But you also, I mean, I had a student come to me about 10 years ago, an adult student who had had piano when he was younger and came back to it. And he played the Brahms A major intermezzo. And I said to him, what's your fingering? And he said, I've never written in a fingering in my life. Well, it showed. But fast forward, he comes now to every lesson with his problem spots marked, questioning the fingering. Why does it work better? You know, and I have to say, it's just so rewarding that he understands now the value of the choreography. It really does make a difference. I wanted to go back to one small thing that I think is important to address because it came up. I was just co-leading, I led the resource group at the symposium with my dear friend Barbara Benacos. And one of the things that was very difficult for me when I first was injured is that, number one, I had always been a teacher and a player, but I also needed to teach to make money so that I could go to New York and retrain. And so I was afraid when I was teaching because I knew what I had been teaching was wrong, but I didn't yet know what was right. And I felt very much in the crossfire in my own mind. What do I tell them? What do I not? And so I asked the advice of my teacher, Eleanor, at the time. And what I ended up deciding is to just watch their hands and to see what they were doing naturally and where they were breaking their alignment or where they were prone to twist or stretch. And I was able to put those things in at the very earliest level or at the very beginning of teaching any student of any level. Mm-hmm. And that calmed me down. I didn't give them the whole picture because I didn't know the whole picture. I still don't. But, you know, I didn't know enough at that time to know what I was really doing. So when Eleanor helped me with that, it made a difference. And then as I grew in my training and understanding, I was able to then add that into my teaching. So that's why I say, if you want to be certified, study and work on your own training, and then you'll be ready to enter the certification program. Mm-hmm. With the help, I mean, a teacher in the institute is the guiding light, I believe, when you should apply for certification. But also, if you read the requirements, you know, you can look and say, do I know what I think it takes or what they're looking for?
That is super helpful. You know, for me, who is, again, just starting out with this work, understanding it, going to weekly lessons and trying to learn as much as I can, but also trying to provide for a family in teaching. That is super, super helpful because, you know, folks that are in the Taubman work, we're often very circumspect about what we're trying to deliver and what we're trying to communicate. And that is super, super helpful because that puts my mind at ease.
Well, good, because I really think the certification process and the becoming certified, it's wonderful. I feel totally grateful that I have been able, I mean, the greatest day of my life was when I was told that I had received it. You know, I mean, this was because I worked so hard to get there. But the goal is to get better. It's not to be certified. That's getting better and getting more understanding of everything will lead to a better understanding of the work. And then, you know, I think there's a lot of people who know a tremendous amount who say, I don't really want to be certified. To each his own, you know, but I think it has to do with being excited about the discoveries and trying to implement them. And if it, I mean, it took me a long time, and it's not a quick fix thing. And I have people all the time who come to one lesson and say they want to get certified. But this isn't like, you know, taking a program to become an EMT or, you know, CPR certified or something, where you take a couple classes and for good reason.
That's right.
But it's an education process that for me to teach people what they need to know. And that's why I say, in fact, I will say, I remember this now. I remember thinking, you know, I'd love to get certified, but what I really love more is learning more and understanding more.
Wow, that's excellent posture.
And I finally just took the focus away from certify or not and just thought, I just love learning this. And I remember, you know, every time I've had a symposium or any interaction, I feel so excited about it. And yeah, my day is better. And I keyed into that, you know, that this really matters.
Yeah, that's excellent. Just going along the learning journey, learning as much as you can, being mentored, humble, to come to a place of beginner mind, so to speak, to ask those questions.
You know, everybody starts wherever they are, and wherever you are is wonderful, because everything, even if you think, oh, I can't do what I used to do. I mean, it's easy to look back and feel grief and feel upset with perhaps your previous teachers but, you know, I said to the resource group, you know, the mind can only think about one thing at a time.
That's right.
And it's fine if you need to look back and experience the grief and deal with that. And I understand all that. I mean, I had plenty of it myself. But also, if you focus on what you've gained at the last lesson, in the last session, or at the symposium, and you start putting it into practice in the best way possible, it helps dispel some of what you feel you lost.
Yeah.
Because you're really, yes, maybe you lost that, but you really are gaining the prize.
Yeah.
Because I just thought, when I couldn't play things in my past life, I thought, I'm just not talented enough. It's just the way it goes. I guess this is my limit.
Yeah.
But that wasn't it at all. I just didn't have the right tools or skill set.
This has been a wonderful conversation. Thank you so much, Elizabeth, for joining us today inside the Taubman Approach. And we will certainly continue this conversation, I'm sure, in another episode. We could go on and on. This has just been so inspiring to me. Thank you so much for joining us.
Well, thank you for having me, really. It's my pleasure to talk about something that has changed my life, unlike most anything else.